cargo baggage, please. So if you might open your baggage and just do a search for bombs.
Mr. J, you're in Hawk Division. Mr. Cloud?
Here.
You're in Blake Division.
Thank you.
Mr. Davis?
Yeah.
Blake Division.
They're coming to be turned into naval officers by a place called Dartmouth. An officer who spent most of the Second World War in a Japanese prison camp said when he was released that it hadn't been too bad if you compared it with Dartmouth. When the First World War Admiral Jackie Fisher joined the Navy, he had only to jump naked over a chair to test his fitness and to write out the Lord's Prayer to test his education. Now, things have changed, and though Nelson might spin in his tomb, they even have women here.
My father's in the Navy, and I knew a few wrens, and thought it'd be quite good fun.
I came here to Dartmouth a long time ago when I was 16, and I think the reason why I joined was really that my mother liked the uniform. I think the pressure came from her. I'd like to know, why are you coming?
It's a challenge, a great challenge, and I'd like to be able to see when I'm middle-aged, 45, look back and say, you know, I've done something with my life.
I'm going to be an instructor officer, which is basically a teacher in uniform. I've been doing research up till now, and quite well-paid research, 4,000 a year, and there aren't too many jobs around that will pay a better salary than that.
I'm already serving Queen and Country as a rating. Like everyone else, I've got ambition and I want to do the best that I can, both in my interests and in the Navy's interests.
So what's this place for?
Well, basically, making you an officer and a gentleman as the Royal Navy see you should be. You know how to handle yourself with different people. You're always polite and you tend not to lose your temper quite so easily as you might if you're in City Street.
Do you need that kind of training, do you feel? I'm really asking, do you feel you're not a gentleman at the moment?
Not as much a gentleman as I could be.
I just want to welcome you to the Britannia Royal Naval College at Dartmouth, which is, as you probably know, the Navy's only initial officer training establishment. Now, in the weeks and months ahead of you, you're going to be taught to act and think like naval officers and leaders of men. But there may be one or two of you who find, after you've been here for a while, that you feel you may have made a mistake. Please discuss it with your divisional staff as soon as possible, because it's in your interests and our interests that if you do have doubts, that we get them ironed out, or if they are such that we cannot sort them out for you, then we wouldn't wish to waste your time or ours any further.
Hats are worn both inside and outside the college by officers under training. On a question of privacy, as some of you may have seen already, some rooms in the division overlook or are overlooked by others. I'm told that the bathrooms are clearly to be seen by the block behind, D block. They, of course, deny it fiercely. Be warned.
I've got a degree in botany and geography, which is totally useless when actually trying to get a job. I sort of wandered around a bit. I went out to Belgium for a couple of years and did a job out there as a dental assistant to an army dentist, and came back to UK and again and couldn't get a job. So I did a secretarial course, and then worked in London for 6 months. And I was so tired of rushing in and out on the tube and this sort of thing. I didn't feel that the work that I was doing was particularly essential. And I thought, well, I'd like to do something a bit different.
Everybody take the caps off. Go. Good. If you want to carry on, independently, put your caps back on. Carry on.
this way. That's it, fine.
I was having a fabulous social life up in London. Didn't really join for that. But I know it is good fun, and I know what naval life is like. And I can accept the discipline, because we sort of had so far the storming up and down the quarter deck at home anyway.
Once she's got to the end and she's finished the inspection, you place yourself in front of her again.
I think very few people are going to be sort of led astray or sort of find the men around the place more attractive than the thought of getting through the course. Because, again, I don't think I'm going to have much time.
Awful on the left. Come forward in the left of the front rank and the left of the centre rank. Keep glancing out the corner of the right eye.
Hello, gentlemen.
Hi.
Please. 6:30.
How did you sleep?
It's best to show that. Look at this.
Jesus, look at that.
Well, right, everything's all right. I think.
Wait. Could you try a cap on, please?
Six. Go down the waist, so.
The lengths are better.
Two evening shirts, collars attached.
You'll find you have no union, there's no clock watching, and other members of the community will demand high standards from you.
Since 1905, every king and Prince of Wales has been trained at the RNC, and latterly we've had the Prince of Wales.
When we drink the laurel toast at the mess dinner, and you'll be hearing more about that later, we remain seated. Most odd, isn't it? Because Charles II once stood up, bumped his head on a low beam, and didn't like the idea of standing up again in a warship.
So far. Whereas 20 years ago BRNC possibly recruited young men from the private education sector, today the educational system is a lot broader. And I think that we're getting young men joining who are academically well qualified, but as far as being well-rounded young men, this is not so. They're lacking self-confidence, for example, and bearing.
Somebody said it. What was it? Harley's.
I'm 18 years of age. I went to a comprehensive school at Stonehaven. I left there to come here. No, I haven't been any work at all.
Your huntresses.
It was the Air Force for me for a while. Actually, I was in the Air Training Corps, and I went away to a few camps, RAF camps, and I became pretty disillusioned with it. I think there's more opportunity for travel as well in the Navy, like in September, if I last out that long. Off to the Mediterranean.
The Admiralty Interview Board have gone through a selection process, and they've sent us a group of young men. But there are still some weak fish in that group, and we like to put them under a certain amount of stress and test their motivation.
Stress is inflicted as enthusiastically on the women as on the men.
Good effort there. Come on, go, go, go. Come on, it's only pain. Come on, don't cheat. Nearly, almost again. Shoot. Nearly again. Come on, watch your head. And another point. And again. Good effort. Now you've got to climb over and get it. That's it. Lean over. Come on in, over the top, come on, it's only pain. Down we go. If you suffer from claustrophobia, hard luck. Come on, go, go, go. That's it, work, work, work. You should be coming through there. That's it, well done, that's good. That's it. Come on, go, go, go. Hurry up, that's it. Keep it going, girls. That's it, work, work, work. You've had 20 seconds so far. That's good. Well done. Up you go. That's it, good. Through the parallel bars. Through there, well done. That's working hard. Yeah, we're struggling a little bit there. Try and catch him up. We've got to get round at least twice. That's good. Well done. That's it. And work your way across. That's good too. You've got to encourage each other, ladies, because it's a team effort. You only get 1 point for every time we go round complete. That's it. Work, work, work. Through there. Down underneath. Over the box and through the tunnel again. Come on, you're near enough out of a minute now. Well done. That's it. Good. Well done. That's a good effort. Come on, it's only pain. I think we could do it. We're nearly there. We're going to struggle through now, but we're going to try, aren't we? That's it. Work, work, work. That's it. Keep it going. Come on, you got 5 seconds to go. Come on, you could get through the tunnel in that time. Come on. Effort, effort.
Yeah, fine.
Great. Right, I'm the next.
Cheers.
Now then, how would you like it?
Do I get in choice?
All right, where you go?
I'm 27, which is about 10 years older than the normal intake. The most difficult thing is going to be the fitness side. I heard that there was a 50-yard swimming test. Well, I can do that fairly easily. Knees on, that's a different matter. Pick bricks up normally, but this thing is different.
Stretch, kick, kick, kick. Come on. That's it. Come on.
Is it important to have made it?
I think so, yeah. Yeah, it's something that's expected of you. It's a challenge. You know, most of my life has been running on challenges, mostly of an academic type. It's a bit different.
My name's Howard Alexander, and unlike many people, I didn't join the Navy straight from school, but I had several jobs. When I first left school, I started off as a postboy in a large transport company in London. And after 3 years, I'd worked my way up to the exalted position of assistant to the assistant accountant. Unfortunately, the salary didn't quite fit in with the title. So I left there and started work for a landscape gardening company. I worked there for about 4 months and got a bit bored with cutting the grass around Hyde Park Corner and became a milkman. But the worst thing was getting up at 4:30 and start the job. I was 19 at the time, running my prime of going out with girls, and it just didn't fit in with my social life. But I've been here 2 days now, and already I'm in a bit of trouble. I managed to upset the boatman down at Sand Quay the other evening. I went down there to take a boat out. I knew roughly where the office was. I wandered over, went in, and the boatman was just sitting there and sort of appeared to ignore me. So I presume that I was supposed to help myself to the keys to the boat lockers. Went over, helped myself, and he fell on me like a ton of bricks. That's managed to get back up through the system that I upset the boatkeeper. He's used to dealing with midshipmen that strayed out of school. It upset me quite a bit, you know, that I should have to kowtow to a boatman after 10 years in the Navy.
Quick! Left, right, left, 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 right, left, 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 right, 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 left, 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 left Right about, always right about.
You know, you kept going all the time, right from 6 o'clock in the morning right through till... Well, average time, about 12:30 at night. And that's about it. And then the only time you really get to think is when you get in your pit at night. You kind of crawl into your pit, and you know, the lights are out, and then you can finally you think about what am I doing here, you know, what's it all for?
Understand most of the language?
Good, 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 good. Okay.
It's 4 days into the course, and one young man has already changed his mind and left. Dartmouth is used to that. They tell of one schoolboy who arrived, saw just the outside of the college, and quit there and then.
Quick, Mark. Time. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left, 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 right, left.
Just try and keep the step, right, marking time. There. Nice, steady pace, right? If you put your feet flat on the ground, they won't go anywhere. They won't go to the left or right. They go straight up and down.
Kevin 875, ready for answer. Initiate the pain for you.
Here is pain. Thanks very much. Here is 5.
Here is 5.
How are you settling in?
Not too badly, sir.
You haven't used that cap for a couple of days. Got to remember to keep the dust off the beak at all times, okay?
Sorry.
It soon gets dusty in here. You've got a lot of work to do on those shoes too before divisions next Sunday, okay? Not just the toe. Ask your sea daddy to teach you how to bullet. And remember the backs as well as the fronts. All right, it's coming along. More progress, please. Where have you been this afternoon?
On the river, sir. Did my bosun dinghy test.
Bosun dinghy. Did you pass?
Yes, sir.
You've neglected the peak of your cap as well, haven't you?
Yes, sir.
Shoelaces, tightly up all the time.
Yes, sir.
Same with the boot laces as well.
Yes, sir.
First of many, I hope. Yes, sir. You too with your shirts. They're nicely folded. They've got to be pressed before you command the ground.
Yes,
ah. Use number 8 shirt?
Yes, sir.
Right, as soon as it's used, in the bottom drawer. When did you last check the life jacket?
Thursday, sir.
Right, fair enough. Thank you very much.
Thanks, sir.
It's dirt under this basin. And the bulkheads round about need washing down as well.
175 would-be officers joined. By the end of the term, the Navy expects at least 20 of them to fail or resign. A fortnight in, 7 have gone, and another is about to go.
I have the honour to request that I may be withdrawn from naval training. I have found life at Britannia Royal Naval College unbearable, with great priority given to things of a trivial nature. I believe that to become a successful naval officer must be totally dedicated and have a lot of respect for the service. And this is something that I can't give to this institution, having been here for 2 weeks. I request that I may leave before I rebel against the system and cause embarrassment and trouble for myself and the service. I have the honour to be, sir, your humble and obedient servant, Shane Cloud, midshipman. I left it for a week and phoned up my parents, asked them what they thought. They said, it's up to you, but leave it for another week or so, which I did, but you know, things just started getting worse. So,
What was it?
Oh, it's the trivia, the pettiness of the whole thing, you know. Everything is, you know, the attention to detail and the priority they give to such simple, petty things, like dust. I mean, if they find dust anywhere, you know, it's a crime. Some people come in with white gloves on the top of a table, you know. Funny, they shouldn't be here. And, you know, they climb up onto the walls and onto the bed and along the top there and inside lights and every little crook and cranny everywhere, you know. Shouldn't be dust there at all. That's ridiculous, you know. It's just...
Isn't that sort of thing necessary to give you a training, to make you regimented if you're going to run a fighting ship?
I don't think so. Not so much. It comes to the stage that even menial tasks, even simple tasks, you can't do. You become so depressed, so nervous. I'm constantly aware when you hear of being watched 24 hours a day, kind of 1984 thing.
20 years ago, people weren't allowed to leave. Once they were in, they were in. Now it only takes a letter of resignation and the price of the kit they've used to put them back in the outside world.
I've got the necessary qualifications to get into a Scottish university here. I'll try my hardest. I think it's taught me something about myself. I don't think I'll ever forget it. But I can't see me ever wanting to come back. No.
Goodbye, Jim.
At the risk of misquoting Shakespeare, some are born leaders, some achieve leadership, and some have leadership thrust upon them. But for most of us, leadership is a quality we pursue in the same way as a professional subject in the syllabus. Quite simply, we work at it. So much has been said, so much written, and so much good drinking time has been wasted towards its understanding that the position of leadership has become elevated to that of an idol. Neither art nor science, leadership is something in which we improve in direct relationship to the amount we practice it. In our first sketch, we deal with loyalty to juniors. A junior must be loyal to his seniors. Similarly, it is essential that seniors give their juniors backing as well. Our first scene, the flight deck of a frigate in harbour.
Excuse me, sir. It says in daily orders that Standeasy will be fitted in as convenient with storing ship today.
Oh, really?
Yes, sir. It's normal Standeasy time now, sir. Shall I pipe it or shall I go and ask the First Lieutenant?
No, go ahead and pipe it. Last load's almost inboard as it is.
Aye, aye, sir.
Easy! Who's the fool that pipes Standeasy?
Me, sir.
What did I put in daily orders? Standeasy will be piped as convenient, and you go and pipe it without asking
but
me.
Sir!
Just as another boat is coming alongside.
But sir!
You're totally incompetent. I'll take that leading seaman's hook off your arm unless you buck up. I'll not tolerate fools as QMs. Tell the chief GI to give you a job change to go somewhere who won't do any damage in the future.
Aye, aye, sir.
Very firmly clenched. And this is because that when we're speaking, our jaws come down, we use the hinge muscles of our mouths. When you've got your teeth clenched, you've got to use all these muscles much more firmly. So when you have a go with all your teeth clenched, it'll feel horrible.
Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled pepper. A peck of pickled pepper Peter Piper picked.
Get your lips moving.
If Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled pepper, where is the peck of pickled pepper Peter Piper picked?
Fine. I don't want to alter accents. You've got a very slight accent. You don't want to alter your way of speaking, do you?
No.
But what you do want to do is to speak absolutely clearly, because you are going into a profession where communication is absolutely essential.
When I was at Dartmouth about 20 years ago, I came from a grammar school, and I found that everyone who mattered here talked with what seemed to me to be a very la-di-da sort of accent. And I learned to speak like them almost overnight because I felt that I had to. Now, I don't think that sort of social pressure exists here anymore, does it?
No social pressure to talk posh. But there's a lot of pressure not to, let's say, use slang. They don't like slang or bad language. I've just had a threatening with a captain's warning because of my bad language, which was last week. And although at the time I didn't consider it to be coming out too thick and fast, as far as a naval officer goes, it's just not on.
Where does that one go?
Here.
7 weeks in, 6 weeks to go, and now Rosalind Tyler's in trouble.
I was the one and only person on the course to be given a commander's warning. I tend to be slightly dilatory in getting things like essays in. And here, if you don't hand something in on time, it's considered a total lack of self-discipline. Then we went on an exercise in the moor for 2 days. And I'm not a very fast walker, and I found it very, very tough going. No sooner you got somewhere, you thought, ah, oh, great, you know, we've finished, you know. And then sort of trudging off another 3 miles and blisters on the back of my heels, which are totally agonising. And I think I looked miserable, and I certainly felt miserable, and I think one's not supposed to look miserable, however bad you feel. So this didn't go down terribly well. And then the final straw, I did a duty. I was so tired, I just didn't think the whole day. First officer hauled me in and said, you're going on commander's warning. At which stage I sort of rushed out, promptly found a friend and burst into tears, because I mean, I've never been so miserable in all my life. The commander said I was mediocre. What a horrible, horrible expression. And told me that unless things improved, that I'd be out of my ear. You know, you don't get a second chance after commander's warning.
Come on, lads, okay. One, two on the sit-ups, three on the pull down. Okay, we're gonna 5 on each exercise, keeping your timer with me. Remember, it's only pain, grit your teeth. Call me what you like, but under your breath. Okay, stand by and we move round clockwise. Stand by, go. One, and two, and three, and four, and five, and off, and move round on the squats. On the bench, and stand up, upright position. No, squats there, come on, think, think, think. Go, one, two, three.
Even an old hand like Howard Alexander can find himself under attack.
A bit slow then, let's go again. Stand by, keep smiling, show your teeth, that's good. Here we go again. Go, one, and two, three.
It's not been easy. I was on a captain's warning at the end of week six. My division officer said that I had an abrupt, sometimes verging on disrespectful manner. This needed to be worked on if I was going to pass the course. I found the hardest part of the course was on the survival exercise. We had no food for the first 4 days, and they sent us out on a false march. I just couldn't run in a straight line anymore. In fact, two of the smallest chaps on the course had to half carry me. Next morning, we had our first food. They gave us a rabbit to kill, and the first time I hit it, I didn't kill it properly. I didn't enjoy that at all.
Come on then. Two, no, bag us down. Three, come on. And four. Come on, and five. Well done, and we move again. That's good news. Come on, we're not sweating yet, none of us. One, two. Come on, Mark, a little bit more effort. Come on. That's it. Grit your teeth. A little bit more effort. And five, and move around again. I'm counting, not you. You keep going if I miss counting. That's it. Stand by. Go. One. Two. Come on. A little bit more. Three. Come on. Five. Four. Five. I want one more. I want one more. Get out of there. Get out of there. Come on. And no, right. Stand there. Stay. Keep down there.
We bring them out onto Dartmoor for 3 days and 2 nights under fairly uncomfortable conditions. They only have a tarpaulin to sleep under, and on their initiative depends on how comfortable they're going to be. The exercise gets harder as they go along, and we hope to put them under pressure during this last 24 hours to really find out what makes them tick.
Is it stick and carrot? Are you pushing fairly hard from behind?
Well, as time goes on, we have to exert a bit more stick and a bit less carrot. There's very little carrot involved with tramping around Dartmoor for 3 days, except the fact that at the end of 3 days it's going to end.
Good job.
get ourselves, all our gear, from point A to point B. Using those barrels, drums rather, the rope, our tarpaulin, and the staves. Plan roughly, make a raft, canvas on top, staves underneath, barrels attached to the staves, using the small lashings we've got on the stretch at the moment. Okay? Right, let's get to it, gentlemen.
The pressure is exerted quite often, not so much by us, but by the actual environment and the weather. At the end of last term, I had a particularly harrowing experience when I did have a chap who very nearly died on me, and I had to get him into hospital very rapidly.
I just lie over it.
Yeah, all right, lie over him. Good idea. Spread your weight, that's it. That's the right, boys. Now to sink, swim. Good luck. That's right. Aim for the nearest point.
Come on,
boys, not much further now.
Yes.
Keep it going. That's right.
You see some amazing solutions. An international officer who, when he approached the clay pit, his solution, of course, was for everybody to take their clothes off and swim. Now, I suppose if he'd succeeded in getting everybody to do it, he would have got 10 out of 10 for leadership. But as it was snowing and raining at the time, he didn't meet with very much success.
Can you get it out? Send it across with these people.
You're going to pilot the next one, mate.
Yeah. That's an urgency there. You've got less than 10 minutes to go. Come on now, pilot, move.
I have a theory on these exercises that the degree of common sense shown is actually inversely proportional to the number of degrees held by the members in the teams. And on a graduates exercise, we actually had one team on the same task who built their raft and floated it and then stood back and discussed whether they'd actually got the metacentric height in the wrong place, which confused me a bit because I didn't know what it was. And they spent their time taking it back in again and rebuilding it in order to construct it with the correct metacentric height instead of just getting stuck in and getting across.
Come on, watch yourself.
Slide jacket off, Tim. Don't just stand there. Come on, move it!
OK, the first thing was you left yourself until last. Now, that was the major fault, because if you'd come over about number four, you'd have had those rucksacks up, you'd have had somebody thinking in terms of the stretcher, and you'd have had the man up, you'd have had everything up on top. As it was, you lost nearly a quarter of an hour at the end. Right, from then on, you begun to get things going, but ever so slowly. You had people tired, they were loafing. You almost had trouble when you told someone to pick up a rope. It very nearly didn't happen.
Okay.
Oh, is that give me the orange.
You are standing on my finger. You are on my finger,
John.
My friend.
John.
Take that into the rope.
John, you're standing on his finger.
You have to move it.
So far.
Bir sıfat bir güvenin, bir sıfat.
Keep it coming. Is it good, Bright? Hang on there, baby. Come on, one more.
That they'd never get invited out to dinner again after that beautiful exhibition, because she sneaked in quietly to see it because she'd never seen it before either.
It's hard work. I think it's a fantastic place for holiday, but I think that we've worked so hard we can't really enjoy Dartmouth as much as we'd like to.
I thought everyone had a go.
I was on the Plymouth for 2 years and we had our own wasp town.
managed to get off there.
I was winched up when we had the...
Now the training's beginning to include cocktail parties. Now, they talk about officers and gentlemen. Does this have to do with the gentleman side of the business?
I'm sure it does. Once again, if I went to a dance or I belong to a fishing club and you go to the annual dance at the fishing club, if I happen to have too many drinks and keel over, then that would just be a good joke for the rest of the year. Good old Howard keeled over at the dinner and dance. I can't possibly afford to do something like that at a cocktail party. It would embarrass the Navy, it would also embarrass the guests. So I can be myself, but a sober, entertaining myself rather than I completely enjoy myself.
If that milkman that you used to be was here watching you now, what would he think about it all?
He'd probably think it's a bit lardy dar.
So by Jerry O'Donoghue says he always comes last, so he's asked me to give room.
Yours wasn't the one that sank, was it?
Well, it capsized. It kept afloat, but it capsized twice.
The main quarter
at the top.
It's
yes, it is. That's about your wife.
Yes, I am. Mm-hmm.
She's at Portsmouth Chatham.
Leon Solomon.
Leon Solomon. In your own house.
One of the things that cocktail parties are used for is in the old days they used to show the flag while driving a gunboat up to a port. Nowadays, we have to be a bit more diplomatic and we take a ship into a port and we have lots of cocktail parties. You entertain foreigners. Try and give them a good impression of Englishmen or of Britain, and we're representing our country in that way.
My uncle was commanding this sort of resident UN battalion there before it all blew up, and of course it all blew up.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the service, we unashamedly attempt to steer you towards a set of conventional rules of manner, which is the definition of etiquette. We do not expect you to forget overnight all you have been taught by your mummies, but we do expect you to be capable of holding your own in the company of anyone, from members of the Royal Family, Her Britannic Majesty's Ambassador Costa Rica, the Commander-in-Chief of the Swiss Navy, to the Lady Mayoress of Bootle.
The etiquette lecture, that was something else, to be quite honest. The bits that really stick out. The nice thing to have remembered is you're supposed to have a drink beforehand, but you must never roll up half cut and sort of walk in, give the hostess a nice big smacking kiss, chat up the nicest looking birds, and move into the corner and monopolize everybody.
The etiquette lecture was really rather extraordinary. It was very amusing. We were taught, amongst other things, how to use a knife and fork. This I found rather odd. Most people know how to use knives and forks anyway, but obviously some people don't. I think as far as the Wrens were concerned, well, it was an amusing lecture, but I mean, it didn't really apply to us. I think perhaps for some of the men it might have given a few handy hints.
Wren's bedrooms, or cabins as they call them, have fitted carpet on the deck, the Admiralty's concession to femininity. The pin-ups aren't always Robert Redford or Steve McQueen. They're sometimes county-class destroyers and nuclear submarines. The fact that the Wrens will never actually serve in a ship doesn't discourage Rosalind Tyler. She's swatted her way through the end-of-course exams, and she's still brushing up her officer-like qualities.
I was asked to go and see Commander T literally just before exams, and he said that I'd been working much harder and put a lot more effort in, and he was going to take me off warning. It was a good time to take one off before exams. And, you know, he sort of said, well, congratulations in having improved so much and make sure I continued. So it was quite a relief, I can tell you, it really was. So, you know, just got the exams and the exam results and everything like that.
Yesterday I went home for my wife, to see my wife. She had a baby, young girl.
well, fairly young, I suppose. £7, 12 ounces. Very pleasing news.
All went well.
Very straightforward.
And what about here at the college?
Well, in the same morning, I heard the news that I've passed the exams, which is always a relief. You know, you hope you've done the preparation, but when you've actually got it in black and white, that's a great thing. And to celebrate, I've bought myself a sword, which, you know, is a nice piece of prestige. These things are very expensive, too expensive, I think, to buy new. They cost about £230 new. But this one I managed to find second-hand, which saved me £100.
Board! Eyes! Right!
One of the famous things about Nelson was that he was prepared to disobey orders if he thought it right. Are you training Nelsons here?
I think that's an interpretation that he was prepared to disobey orders. Perhaps a kinder view would be that he was a man who used his initiative. And if that is what you mean, most certainly we're very keen that people should use their initiative. We can give them a baseline here for their training and how to be a naval officer. But in the end, it's the individual and his personality and initiative, which is the important thing. I don't think we've ever wanted to turn out a sort of identikit naval officer. I think it's very important that individuals should be able to show their own personalities.
This is supposed to be the final passing out parade rehearsal, but tradition has it that we turn up in fancy dress and generally mess around to our heart's content on the parade ground and cause the staff as many problems as possible. Most people would think this is a public school thing, but it's not. It's one of the new traditions of Dartmouth. And in fact, the terms compete with each other to try and put on a better exhibition than the last one. People have driven flocks of sheep onto the parade ground. They once even hired a bus and drove past in the bus and did their salute from inside the bus.
Hands in pocket for your attention, sir!
John Payne, still trying to become the Navy's idea of a gentleman, has two more terms to do.
He goes into them under captain's warning for deficiencies in character and leadership, which means he could be failed at any moment.
When you joined the Wrens, you must have had some idea of what you thought life in the Navy was going to be like. Has it been like that?
Some of it has, sir, yes.
Have you enjoyed it more than you expected, or less?
I've enjoyed it more.
Good. What do you like? What have you enjoyed most?
The variety. One's to rush around doing so much.
Where's your home?
Sussex. We went to see our appointer. She came down here. And we went in alphabetical order. Of course, I'm right at the end. She said, good morning, Third Officer Tyler. So that was terrific. And she said, well, you're through, and told me where I was going next. To HMS Heron, which is an air station at Yeovilton in Somerset. Quite a big air station. And I'm going to be working in the commander's office as General Dog's Body. I think it's a career, it's a very good career for a woman, but you never know, Miss Wright might come along.
Lieutenant John Davis has 2 weeks' leave with his family and the new baby. Then he's going to teach his subject, aeronautics, at a shore station. They've accepted him for 5 years. He hopes to make it a permanent career.
What are the things that have stood out in your mind about the training here?
The amount of physical effort that's needed, as much as anything else, sir.
Did that surprise you a bit?
It certainly did, sir, yes.
Yeah. I always claim that there is a strong connection between physical fitness and mental alertness. The doctors don't always back me up, I regret to say, but I'm convinced in my own mind it's there.
I'm sure you're right, sir.
I reckon I'll be the fittest admiral in the business.
Okay, thank you very much.
Well, I've passed. I'm sub-lieutenant now. Next, we go to Greenwich for 6 weeks on the knife, fork and spoon course, as it's known. They teach of the broader aspects of social life in the wardroom, also the broader aspects of defence policy and some naval history.
Shane Cloud, the 18-year-old who said no to what Dartmouth stands for, has been accepted at Dundee University. He starts there this month studying electrical engineering.